Ladies and gentlemen, as you know, I've been asked to do this political commentary. And I must say, being political, I'm sure a lot of you are saying to yourselves, what the bleeding hell does he know about it? I'm sure a lot of you are saying that. And I am, for a start. Well, I'll tell you how it happened. You see, I was sitting at home, and suddenly there was a knock on the wall. And it was the woman next door, so I put my sort of head out the window, and she put her head out of her window, and she said, you're wanted on the telephone. Because she is the only person in the street who has a telephone, and that's because she's in civil defence. She said, you're wanted, so I went round there, see? And she said, it's the BBC on the phone. So I thought to myself, BBC? So I said, I wonder what they want. Well, she said, actually, they want you to do a summing up of the general election. So I said, well, I mean, I know nothing about that. She said, that's what I told them. So I thought, yes, yes. So I thought, right, mate, it's the last time you get me on your stretcher. So anyway, I picked up this telephone. I picked up the phone, and it was the BBC operator. And she said, Mr. Sherrin to talk to you, Mr. Sherrin. His voice came on, you see. Ned here. So, in any case, the only Ned I know is a donkey on Blackpool Sands. So anyway, I spoke to Ned, and he said, is that Mr. Howerd? I said, yes. He said, I'm free. So I said, yes, he didn't press charges. He said, if you could pop over here. So I said, well, where are you? Well, he said, I'm in the club. So I nearly said to him, BBC, go for pudding. And I thought, I don't know. Well, I once said that to BBC producers in all three. The last time I appeared on Woman's Hour. Anyway. So he said, we want to do this election summing up. And he said, as you know, he said, after all, 80% of the people in this country know nothing about elections. Poor dears. And he said, well, we would like someone to represent them. Obviously, the BBC classed me as a moron, but a specialist. So we'll start now the political commentary. Now, first of all, Harold Wilson, the Labour Party leader. Now, I don't know Harry very well, of course, but... What can I say? Now, this seems to be a man who epitomises the man in the street, the ordinary man. I mean, suppose, for instance, you met him in a crowd of people in the high street, you know, and you didn't know who he was. You didn't know what he did. I mean, what would you put him down as? Bookies runner? Could be anything, you see. Now, here we have, of course, Mr. Joe Grimmon. Now, J-O, of course, which is short for J-O-E, and which is, well, understandable, it's less common. And, Mr. Grimmond, of course, the sex kitten of politics. Now, Mr. Joe Grimmond, of course, is the MP for the Orkneys, with his house in Kew Green, London. And this is Mr. Wilson, of course, who is MP for a part of Liverpool, with his house at Hampstead. Ladies and gentlemen, Sir Alec Douglas Hume, of course, who has a constituency in Scotland, which I think he owns, as a matter of fact. Now, you may be saying to yourselves, because he has a constituency in Scotland and his home is in London, and you may be saying to yourselves, now here you have leaders of the party who can choose any constituency they like. Now, why do they choose a constituency hundreds of miles away in the north, you know, from their homes? And of course the answer is very simple, so they can't be got at. Well, wouldn't you? I would, I'm telling you. Of course, Sir Alec Douglas Hume was the loser and Mr. Harold Wilson was the winner. Of course, it's partly his own fault, I think, Alec. Oh, I think he's... No, I think he's silly to himself. I'll tell you why. You see, he was going round all this talk and, you see, and he would drag politics into it, and it's ridiculous. I'm sure the Tories have done very, very well, and they can't complain. They've had a run now 13 years, which is almost as long as the mousetrap, so they've done very, very well. And I expect Sir Alec naturally is very upset. I mean, it's only natural, he's, you know, he's human, and I mean, he's very upset. In fact, when he gets back to Scotland, God help the partridges. Anyway, I think, taken by and large, it was a clean fight. The people, I thought, were the shrewd ones, of course, were the Liberals. They were the no heckling there. Very, very cunning, that lot. You see, they carried around their own independent deterrent on a black man. And she goes, hecklers, come on, let's have him. Oh, yes. I like her. She's a nice girl, though. All black leather and punch up. But a nice girl. And, of course, the most exciting night, I thought, was election night itself. I don't know if you noticed or watched television. I thought, I liked it. And, of course, Trafalgar Square. Marvellous, I thought. And all the, did you see those people in the pool all getting soaked? All those floating voters there. And in fact, the only ones who didn't like all that nonsense and noise there was, of course, the pigeons. And they soon fluttered off out of it. And not a sign of them. I'm afraid poor old Nelson lost his deposit that night. But, I thought television handled the whole thing very well. I mean, this is just a personal thing. Please don't think I'm crawling when I say this, but I did think that the BBC handled it more sort of diplomatically. They were more tactful, I thought. I mean, they moved step-toe back to sort of fit. Well, what did the ITV put on before the election results? Burke's Law. Well, I mean, I know a lot of Burkes were standing, but I mean, tactless, to say the least. I thought the commentators worked hard, and old Dick was good, wasn't he? Oh, Dick Dimbleby. I admired him. That man was on duty there from 9:30 in the studio, left about 4 o'clock in the morning. We didn't go out once. Never had a chance to pop outside for a minute. I don't know how he did it. I mean, and of course, he's been dieting, but I prefer him slim, don't you? Oh, I do. I prefer him slim. I didn't like him with so much weight. No wonder they called it Panorama. And of course now, I don't know, the gossip here, they were saying that he sent all his old suits to the campaign War on Want. And now they're looking for a hungry African who weighs 18 stone. Robin Day was very good. I thought he was, he kept his temper just. It was just I suppose when the pills start to wear off, you get a bit too... The only thing that surprised me quite candidly was the fact that the Tory leaders weren't seen on election night. I didn't see any Tories at all. I don't know. So Alec Douglas Hume was apparently in number 10 Downing Street all night, and Reginald Morling was next door, the Chancellor next door, and I don't know. I suppose perhaps the way things were going, Alec thought he ought to, start checking up on the inventory and make sure nothing was missing, because I think, well, I mean, to rush out with anything, you've got everything on, And you go, Rachel was there next door, I suppose, burning the books. And because, it's very understandable. I mean, there's no reason why he should do all those sums and leave it for this, Jim Callahan to take over. I mean, he must cook his own books. So, yes. Now, this is a chart of the various swings, the swings in the trade gaps and things. Now, this is a swing of the... This is polls, actually. The polls. This is the swing. Funny, no. It's a funny thing. No, but honestly, aren't people stupid? Aren't people stupid? There was a woman next door. I was talking to this woman. We were talking about polls, And she was moaning, humming and hawing. I said to her, what do you make of all these polls? What do you think of the Gallup poll? This Gallup poll. She said, Gallup poll. She said, not a nonsense, she said. She said, why do you confine it to people on horseback? She said, I've never seen anything like it. Especially Polish. Sure, there was no point in talking to her, was there? I'm arguing. Well, this is the swing to Labour in 1959, and this swing here is to Tory in 1960, and there's all these... What's these circles? It's tea. Who's been resting teacups on this? I told you. Let's talk about the surprises in the election. Now, there were a lot of surprises as far as the people getting in back into Parliament were concerned, or getting into Parliament. Ernie Marples, I was glad about that because, I like Ernie. Because you give him a few rows and a few little cars to play with. He's very harmless. I thought George Brown was a bit subdued. I did. I know. As you see, every time I saw him on television, you see, for a start, he was supposed to do 60 or more itineraries all over the place talking and 60 places and that, you see, which was a lot. But every time I saw him on TV, he was out in the open air, shouting and these terrible microphones, I'm never tired of my man's and the wind blowing, which is a terrible strain on the throat, All that shouting in the open air, terrible strain. I don't know, I'm so sorry for him. And of course, you see, that's where people are so wicked. See, some people are so wicked, you see. obviously, Harold Wilson had sent him out in these conditions, hoping he'd lose his voice. Well, I think it's a terrible thing to say. In any case, what good does it do? And what good does it do? Because you're out in the cold, and you get, you know, chilly, and after a few days, you know, you think, oh, well, I'll have a few nips, you know, just to cheer myself up, you know, and a few more nips. And before you are, know where you are, you reduce the 6% mortgage interest to 3%. And a few more nips, so you'd be giving the houses away for nothing. Anyway, but I like George. I like old George. He's, you know, he's got, you know, and in the East, he rounded up, and I thought some of the speeches were a bit dull. That's why I thought Quinton was a godsend, didn't you? Quinton Hogg. Oh, I thought at least he'd back things up a bit, you know, Quinton. And I admire him. No, I do, I admire him, because after all, it can't be easy. You think he's going round the country with all these hecklers, you know, and shouting and bawling with a name like Hogg. It's very difficult, you know. I mean, it takes, I think so, courage, and I, luckily, he's got the Quinton in front, which sort of balances up a bit. And because... he's not called Hedgehog, but anyway. Of course, Quinton, of course, I mean, you know, he gets excited and carried away, because in these early burly of the meeting, it's very natural. All this business about, for instance, adultery on the Labour front bench. But that was all nonsense, of course. It's uncomfortable enough to sit there. And the back bench isn't, it's possible, because at least it's more private. But I mean, but of course, did you have much trouble from canvassers? I was canvass silly. And I read there was people knock. I mean, no, in the long run, I said yes to everyone. Yes to everyone, because at the end of the week, I had 3 new vacuum cleaners and 2 life insurances. But they're so persistent, some of them, aren't they? God, what? I won many, he would not go. He was determined to sway me. He did my washing for 3 weeks for nothing. Now, I mean, I said to him, I said, look, I got all the wrong issues. I said, they got the wrong issues. I said, the sort of thing they talk about, I said, people aren't interested in. Not ordinary people. I said, let's have the real issues that matter. Well, he said, like what? I said, well, topless dresses. Now, that's an issue. I said, sure, they could have got something out of that, couldn't they? So he said, well, he said, after all, this is hardly a party topic. I said, it all depends whose party you're at. Just to sum up now, ladies and gentlemen, I must say this, that as you know, Mr. Harold Wilson is now the Prime Minister, and with a very small majority. In fact, if it's a case of 3 old Labourites locked in the gallery, it might be very tricky for him. Anyway... But I want to give him a bit of advice. Honestly, I think this is right. I've thought this out myself. Now, look, this is the government, you see. If they could manage to devalue the pound to 5 and 4, and then buy as many as they can, pound notes, you see, and then bung the price up again, we still make a fortune, you see. It's so simple.